great privilege and a great honor for me to come here to be the new head basketball coach at Xavier University. So the biggest thing I want to promise here is that the students, student athletes in our program are going to get a degree. The fellas that are here now, every ounce of my ability and energy are going to be put forth for those young men to get a degree from Xavier University. We're going to press and we're going to run. That's the way we played last year at Notre Dame. It took me a while to try to get the boss because he's been very successful. We're fortunate to get in some kids that were pretty good in that style of play. And we're going to press and we're going to run and we're going to have an up-tempo style of play.
First time since Pete Gillen took over the helm of the Xavier Musketeers in 1985, the Muskies failed to make it to the NCAA tournament, ending a streak of six consecutive appearances in the Big Dance. The Musketeers, plagued by personal tragedy, early season injuries to key personnel, and without any senior leadership, just couldn't seem to connect.
Just go ahead and lay the ball in the basket.
Xavier finished the year a disappointing 15-12. And to complicate matters, head coach Pete Gillen was once again being courted by the Silk Suitors. This time with Raleigh Massimino moving west to Nevada, Las Vegas, Villanova came calling, and coach Gillen gave the Big East school a good hard look. For a moment, it seemed as if Xavier would be looking for someone to replace the winningest coach in Xavier history. Yet, when it looked bleak, Gillen said thanks, but no thanks.
There was a big sigh of relief that went across the gym when he came in and told us that he was going to stay.
It was mainly a choice between being at the big time with the negatives. What are the negatives? Well, it was a little more stress on a marriage, stress on a wife, stress on a husband, and quality of life. You know, nice there, beautiful area, but not as nice and calm as Cincinnati. What's he going to do to the marriage? What is he going to do to the wife? My wife's an emotional person. She cries when they open supermarkets. You know, she's very emotional. You know, my son cries, you know, if the team he's picking, if, you know, Michigan loses to Purdue, he cries. So we got a very emotional family, and I only can afford a couple of boxes of handkerchief. I'm happy here. This might be my niche where it's best for me to be at, and that's okay. You know, I'd love to go to the Final Four, but if I don't and I'm happy, I can live with that. If I'm there, right, and I have two ulcers and a heart attack and a divorce, you know, and all my hair falls out, then, and that could happen to me, then it's not worth it. So I took a swing at happiness and being with the family rather than go for the glory and the gold.
And that's going to make us want to work harder because he had a chance to go to a great place, but he chose to stay here, so that's just going to make us, you know, work harder.
So with all five starters returning and a nucleus of six seniors, old Joe Bag of Donuts and his staff went back to work on fine-tuning the Xavier ship. Gillen decided not to put any pressure on senior tri-captain Jamie Gladden and junior center Brian Grant to carry the team. So as practice opened, he put the emphasis on defense, got the Musketeers to recommit themselves to working hard and playing hard.
Stronger with the ball. We saw in a game where the ball was ripped out of our hands, a different situation. We got to be strong with the ball.
outside, went for Aaron Williams. Gentry picked up the loose ball. Now the scramble, and he rolls it out to Gladden. Gladden goes inside. Tuckerant, no good. Aaron Williams rebound. Big play.
Into the season, it was time for a little cultural experience for the Musketeers. A trip to the Orient for a tournament in Tokyo, Japan.
Very polite and shy people. In the games, they clap like the theater. You know what I mean? They're not like New York, where I'm going to rip your neck off if you miss another free throw, you know?
I can say hello and nice to meet you for the first time in Japanese.
Ohio is good morning.
So I'll probably say konnichiwa, which means hello. So... or if it's at night, I'll say kombanwa.
What, that sushi, huh?
No, I don't think I'm going to mess with the sushi.
Not too sure I'm ready for some sushi, but I'm ready for some of that fried rice and chicken.
Number 33, Brian Grant.
33, Brian Grant.
Though the Musketeers enjoyed their stay in the land of the sun, they didn't forget their main objective, to win the tournament. And they did that, disposing of Delaware, then Rice.
3連勝ザビエル大学ピート・ギレンヘッドコーチ.
I would like to have the presentation to the tournament champion head coach from Xavier, head coach Pete Gillen.
プレゼンテーターは大和証券株式会社山下義政.
I think I got my confidence going in Japan against Rice, and you know, Coach Gillen asked me, you know, you got your jumper with you? And I said, yeah, I'm going to try to bring it back from Japan, and I guess it stayed with
me. Against Wichita State, Jamie Gladden hit 7 of 10 from behind the three-point arc on his way to a season-high 31 points. The Musketeers raced out to a 55-22 halftime advantage, and the Muskies shocked Wichita State 88-54.
Final 16 seconds, 87-86 Notre Dame.
Look for Gladden at the free throw line.
10 seconds.
Here he comes. He's caught up. Michael Hawkins is going to have to do something else.
Hawkins to Williams. Back to Gentry. 4 seconds left. Got to put it up. Gentry throws it up. No good. And the Musketeers go down by one.
The game that every Xavier fan looked forward to on the non-conference schedule was a January 4th encounter with Notre Dame, especially after a heartbreaking loss to the Fighting Irish in South Bend last season. This time in the friendly confines of the Gardens, before the largest home crowd of the season, the Muskies would not be denied. Irish, the Musketeers had jumped out to an 8-0 mark, the best start in Xavier history. It was during the Notre Dame game that Xavier fans saw the emergence of a long-awaited face. Number 21, senior tri-captain Chris Mack, had finally battled back from two knee injuries to make his first appearance in a Xavier uniform. And no one appreciated it more than the Muskie faithful. superb junior season, opposing defenses knew they had to tighten their grip on senior tri-captain Jamie Gladden, and consequently his point production dropped. But a bigger, stronger, and healthier Brian Grant made them pay in the paint. Huskies in scoring 19 times on his way to earning MCC Player of the Year honors. The Musketeers started a run which saw them win 13 of their next 14 games, including 12 straight conference wins. With Gillen's renewed emphasis on defense, the Musketeers were winning ugly, but winning nonetheless. The Muskies would go on to hold opponents to 42.1% field goal shooting for the season, the best in Gillen's tenure at X. And after a two-year absence, the Muskies also returned to the top 25, climbing as high as 18th in the polls. With a 73-58 win over LaSalle, the Muskies clinched a tie for the MCC crown with Evansville, their fifth MCC title in the last 8 years. And for the fourth time, Gillen was named MCC Coach of the Year. After the Musketeers' win over LaSalle, they were pleasantly surprised with a visit from a friendly face. With the regular season over, it was time for the MCC tournament, the winner getting the automatic bid to the NCAA tournament, a chance to travel to the road to New Orleans. First off, the Musketeers fought off stubborn Loyola. Next, they avenged themselves of a loss in the regular season finale by disposing of the Duquesne Dukes. Then in the MCC Tourney Championship, Evansville avenged themselves two regular season losses at the hands of X. The Musketeers came into the game ninth in the nation in field goal shooting percentage, but the Purple Aces held the Muskies to 36% from the floor on the way to an 80-69 victory, and with it the automatic bid to the Big Dance. All of a sudden, the Musketeers, who just a week earlier looked like a shoe-in for the NCAA tournament, were a team on the bubble.
You know, we came in and watched the pairings, and I saw the first Midwest region go. I go, oh my goodness, and I said, hey, the slots, accounts, I was counting the spots. It was 26, 28, I was counting each one, and then it was like five or six slots in the Midwest. If we don't get one of these next five or six, we're toast.
The number nine seed, Xavier. Yeah!
A lot of work. I think we bounced back from a disappointing year. 15-12 was not the end of the world, but for our high standards, we're very disappointed. And to come back and make the tournament, we're really, really thrilled.
It was back to the Hoosier Dome, where the Musketeers were 3-1 in tournament play, having upset the likes of Missouri in 1987 and Georgetown in 1990. Now the Muskies prepared for the 17th-ranked Privateers of New Orleans and the aircraft carrier Irvin Johnson. Not that Irvin Johnson, this Irvin Johnson. The 6'11 senior, who only 5 years ago was working in a Louisiana supermarket, was now a potential NBA lottery draft pick. As Coach Gillen would say, it was going to be a war. Two teams with identical styles and a game billed as the best contest of the evening at the Hoosier Dome.
And a shot blocked by Urban Johnson, and ahead of the field is Gerald Williams. And it's 4-2 in favor of the Privateers. An up and down game, and at the other end, Brian Grant scores. We won't have any time to say anything. Reggie Garrett going strong to the hoop. And here comes Hawkins back for Xavier. Gladden wide open for the three. Jamie Gladden, the leading three-point shooter for the Musketeers. Inside to Johnson. Urban Johnson, boy, he working well. Like to see him when he's 100%. Winding down the 3 minutes to go in the first half. Williams loops it in to Grant. Grant's there. He's got it again. He's gotten hot all of a sudden to the tune of 8 points. But he has come out strong offensively tonight. And there is Garrett. There's Grant. Brian Grant. Good feed into Urban Johnson. Blocked by Williams. And intercepts that entry pass. Three-point lead for New Orleans. Wide open. Gladden, a three. So Gladden with his second three-point basket knocks the game again at 40. But this is a lot more significant with 10:45 to go. Sykes goes into the backcourt. Dive! Woo! Hold yourself, watch yourself, son.
And they end up with it.
Great save!
What a play!
Great save! That's the way Grant stayed with it. Williams reached in for a two-shot foul.
That was a phenomenal play because they hustled. It could have been backcourt. He could have knocked it into the hands of the other team. And Xavier got the ball and will go to the line.
Right now, Xavier's in control of it. Tyrese Walker goes to baseline. Blocked. And the second effort is good. The basket counts. And a foul. It may be against Melvin Simon. And if it is, it'll be number 4 on Simon. So it's a bigger team for the blue-shirted Musketeers of Xavier.
Want to keep the ball in Gladden's hand.
What a move. What a great pass by Sykes, too.
Boy, oh boy, I'm watching Williams in practice yesterday. He didn't show me anything like this. All of a sudden, now he's like Marvel Man.
Saving it for the game, Al. Why not? 20 points for Aaron Williams.
Spurred on by senior Aaron Williams and Brian Grant, the Musketeers broke open a tight game with a 14-4 run in the second half and held the Privateers at bay for a 73-55 victory. Grant collected 20 points and 10 rebounds, while Williams, in what may have been his best performance in a Xavier uniform, hit for a season-high 20 points, grabbed 7 boards, and blocked 5 shots.
The only difference tonight was the fact that the shots didn't fall for you in the second half, and Xavier took advantage of the opportunities presented.
Well, that would be one way to look at it. And I tell you what, if you're from Ohio and following Xavier, you'd have to say that they had an awful lot to do with that. They had a great defensive plan tonight. Ours probably wasn't as good. And we've been a straight man-to-man defensive team. We've relied on that year, all year long. They've done a great job of post defense all year long. I will say this: Grant is as fine an inside player as we've seen all year long, including Stokes from Arizona.
I just think there was a lot of talk about Urban Johnson and Melvin Simon, and I think we wanted to show the country that Brian Grant and Aaron Williams can also play.
It was eerie for me when we're waiting for the game to start. I knew Knight wouldn't come out to the last 30 seconds. And all of a sudden you hear a roar like the Pope is coming to St. Patrick's Cathedral in Manhattan, or Johnny Carson's coming out.
Coach Gillen billed it as the corporal against the general. Little old Xavier against the Indiana Hoosiers, the number one ranked team in the country. Hundreds of Muskie faithful cheering in the midst of 37,000 fans, most of them clad in Indiana red. Before the tourney began, Sports Illustrated had predicted a possible upset in this matchup, and the Musketeers almost made those predictions come true.
16 on the shot clock. They leave Grant open for the shot, and Brian Grant, averaging 19 points a game, they beat him twice but lost in the conference tournament final. Good pass inside of Williams. It was the two big men, Grant to Aaron Williams, and it's now 12-8. They started 2-for-9 in this game, but they
Gentry plays it. Gladden for three. He's got it.
Big time. That's what I told you earlier.
Albert Cheney with a knocks it back into the hands of Xavier. And the tying basket by Jamie Gladden, who has 9 points and the first tie of this game.
A-Train Williams is a quiet hero for Xavier.
Wide open is Gladden. Jamie Gladden with a three, and that's his second of the ball game. Gladden misses the layup. Williams follows up. Aaron Williams with 12 points. Nine rebounds for Williams as well. Grant and Williams playing a whale of a game out. Indiana trying to advance to the Sweet 16 in St. Louis. They got a big hurdle here. Xavier coming out to play close. Aaron Williams, and it's a one-point game. Hawkins fires away and hits a three. That's his fourth
of the
game.
Can't call timeout. Let the clock run. Take their time.
71-68. They get it in bounds.
Wow.
Let's see. It's
wow. He got away with more than a 5-second count. Wow. That must have been about a 7 count. Tough game. Tough game for IU. Xavier, the type of team that has no weaknesses. They don't have all the great things in the world, but they have no weaknesses.
Xavier's season was over. Indiana would move on to the Sweet 16, but the general and his troops knew they had dodged a bullet.
I think Xavier's a very good team. People don't give them the credit that they deserve. They came out and they played us very tough. I don't think the three little guys for them get enough credit.
They have two guys in Grant and Williams who are, they were really relentless on the boards. It was tough blocking them out.
I'll say it again, they're the toughest team that I think that we play this year. So I'll take my hats off to them.
He said, we got exactly what we expected. We expected Xavier to be a very tough team and you to play us a great game, and we got exactly what we expected. He said, great job. He just shook hands, and I said, hey, wish you the best and hope you win it all. So, he was very kind. He didn't have to be that way. He's a general. I'm a corporal, so it was nice for the general to talk to a corporal.
With the loss to the Hoosiers, the Musketeers' season ended at 24-6. And with the ending of the season came the end of the careers of six Xavier seniors. Eric Knopp, a four-year walk-on, and the recipient of the team's Unsung Hero Award in 1991. Mark Three-Pointer, who earned a full scholarship for the last two seasons after walking on the Xavier roster. Pointer came off the bench several times this season to spark the Musketeers to victory, including a 17-point performance against Dayton, which saw him hit 4 of 4 from behind the three-point arc. Track captain Dwayne Wilson, better known as the Chief. Wilson battled back from knee problems to give the Muskies some significant minutes off the bench, including 21 solid defensive minutes in Xavier's win over Nebraska in the 1991 NCAA tournament. It's the saddest story you've ever heard. That's how Pete Gillen described the plight of Chris Matt. But the pride of St. Xavier High, who was voted as a team captain before he had ever played a Xavier game, turned the saddest story into a happy ending. The A-Train. Aaron Williams finishes career as the all-time leading shot blocker in Xavier history, 12th on the all-time Xavier rebounding charts, and a member of XU's 1,000-point club. Williams often showed Xavier fans his ability to take over a game. Then there's the Iron Man, Jamie Gladden, who started in a Xavier record 121 straight games. Gladden winds up his career 4th on XU's all-time scoring charts and finished with a school record 154 three-pointers. Gladden also earned first-team All-MCC honors 3 consecutive years. And who can ever forget that memorable night in Milwaukee? And last but not least, a goodbye and congratulations to assistant coach Skip Prosser, the first assistant coach from Pete Gillen's original staff in 1985. Prosser will be assuming the head coaching position for the Greyhounds of Loyola, Maryland. In his 8-year tenure at Xavier, Coach Prosser has been a major reason why the Musketeers have been able to nab such talent as Tyrone Hill, Derek Strong, Jamal Walker, and Brian Grant, just to name a few. Responsible for the Xavier backcourt, Coach Prosser was also chiefly responsible for the dynamic guard play that Muskie fans have been accustomed to. They want to get back to the big dance, and they did. They wanted to go down as one of the best teams in Xavier history, and they established that with the 4th best win total in Xavier history. Coach Gillen said, this was a special team with great chemistry, one of the most unselfish teams he's ever been around in college basketball. talented players who also get along so well. And anchored by a strong junior class led by returning starters Brian Grant and Steve Gentry and super sub Tyrese Walker, the future of the Xavier Musketeers remains bright. They just have to keep working hard and playing hard.